Hello, good morning everyone, and welcome to the session. We are starting with Kuli Ek, who is going to give us a presentation with the use of Phosphor G technologies in the HPC environment. So, Kuli, please.
Hello, thank you. Do you hear? Yes, I'm Kuli Ek and I come from CSC ITER's Center for Science from Finland. And the CSC comes basically from Center of Scientific Computing. And we have been running such supercomputers for 40 years, pretty much. And these supercomputers have been mostly been used for chemistry and physics and not geography. But in recent years, we have tried to make use of them in the GS. Just a little bit background of the company, because I think it's maybe quite unique what we have. And the system is basically such that the Ministry of Education orders from us the service, and then it is free of charge for the researchers from the universities and research institutes, so they just can come and use the computers without paying us directly anything. We do all kind of other IT services for universities also, so it's almost 400 people in the house. But in the GIS team, we are currently three, and this is pretty much maximum of the history. For a long time, I was really alone there. In the GIS services, besides this HPC thing, we do also other things. We have a data service which provides about 10 terabytes of data, which is kind of important because we have copied the same data also to the HPC environment to be easily used. And then we organize all kind of courses. Likely not suitable to say here, but we also organize the ArcGIS and mapping for licenses for universities. And we have OpenStreet web services running, but that covers only Finland. So I don't know how many of you know what means HPC. It comes from high performance computing. So it's basically computers filling this room easily and more. And they cost like tens of millions of euros. So it's a little bit different scale than the normal PCs. But the reason for GS usually normally to start thinking about using such computers is that the PC or laptop they are using is not just managing the calculation. It takes either too much time or then just requires so much memory that you even can't do what you're doing. I remember myself in my previous workplace running scripts like 24 hours and 48 hours, and it was possible if you didn't have to do it too often, but it wasn't for. Actually, I have kind of two computers, one for running the things and then other for working. It's a little bit the same, but now you can have this running the things somewhere where you don't actually see the computer. The other use case when the data is so big that even if you're playing around with hard disks, external ones, then it still gets complicated. So there in our environment, the users get by default 5 terabytes of space. But if they have a project which needs more than 5 terabytes, then it can be arranged also. And then another little bit different use case is when the universities organize, for example, Python for GIS courses, then they can get the teaching environment also in our, but then it's not actually the HPC, then it's more such a cloud service that we offer. And besides HPC, we have also such cloud services, as I said, and there. Also, such servers can be run like PostGIS or Geo servers. So this is also one case when the university users come to us. Yes, we have this HPC. We are just changing the system. So also in the slides, I am afraid that you will see both names Taito and Puhti. Taito is currently open. Puhti will be open next week. So we are working actually really hard to have some GS software there also very soon. And this HPC environment is where you have thousands of cores, and the biggest nodes have like 1.5 terabytes of memory, which I counted was like 20 of my laptops in the memory wise, like 200 of my laptops in the memory wise, so it's a lot bigger. And to this HPC environment, we can pre-install software. We can move their data for the users. So when the users come, it's kind of ready-to-use environment. They, of course, must learn a little bit of this HPC systems, like how you actually submit the job and how you load some software. But these are pretty easy things, actually. So I think mostly the biggest challenge for at least the Finnish GS users is to use a Linux machine at all. Very many of them are Windows users, and then they are kind of, I have to type in a black box. But those who have seen Linux before, then I don't see it as a difficult. And we have both CPU and the GPU on the supercomputer side. And then there is the cloud part. Also, there is CPU and GPU, but there the users get kind of, the web server is like nothing. You have to start from setting up the networks and installing all the software, starting from the operating system. So for normal geographer, this is kind of way, way too much to ask. So usually when they have some projects where they need this, then we try to go to your IT department. They can do the basic setup for you. And then when you get to the part that you actually maybe installing GL server, then you can do it. But like the basic steps there are quite difficult. And the thing with the cloud is because everybody can do what they want, they have pseudo rights there, then we can't kind of make anything ready for them. It's then they are on their own pretty much. But to this supercomputer part there, we can kind of help them more. And then I put here what you have to do before start using the systems. For the supercomputer, you pretty much just move your data scripts, change a little bit paths, check that all the software is available, and you're ready to run. But on the cloud side, then there is a lot of the setting up before you can actually do. But then, of course, you are more free what you do. And at least one big challenge in Finland nowadays is that many, many, many of normal GS users, they are used to clicking around, either ArcGIS or QGIS. But they're clicking around there and getting their things done. And when then I tell it, I'm sorry, but you can't use this in this environment, that you need to use scripts, then some of them are okay with that, but for some then it's quite difficult. But basically the way to go with in such a supercomputer environment, it is that you need to have scripts. This can be R scripts or Python scripts or Bash scripts or MATLAB scripts or Julia scripts, as here was yesterday presentation. We have had such GS use in the last 4 years, I would say. And in this time, we have had, I guess, 50 projects maybe there. I put some examples here. I guess handling the big raster datasets is kind of maybe the most common. So it's then different use cases, either it's subtle data analysis or forest modeling or just erosion modeling was done also. But then there was one case when they actually were doing crazy lot of routing. They were just selected like thousands of points and then routed between all of these points. So they had millions of routings to do. And that one they also managed to do it in the end with Python. And the main limiting things in the supercomputer environment is that only software that can be installed to Linux is suitable there. And it's mainly the scripting part also. That you can have a software with graphical user interface there also, but that's kind of just for seeing the results or inputs, not really for working there. And then in the Finnish case, there is really the problem with skills of Linux and general skills. And this is the list of GS software that we have currently installed. As much as I know, this is the longest list of GS software on any supercomputer, but maybe I just don't know. But I know there's one, which is Roger system in States, but there the list was not exactly as long. But basically, we have tried to install as much as we can, and partly also what the users have requested. I think the main ways to use is via Python and R packages, but then the R and Python can access the functions from grass or sagages or something else. The only not open source tool here is this LustTools, which actually provides some only the exe files, but we got them also working with Wine, which was kind of hack, but it works. yeah. And then I put also a slide what we don't have, because some of these have like principal problems. Like anything that is Winless only, we can't put, including the most common commercial ones. And then also server software we can't put to the supercomputer environment. That goes well to the cloud environment, but not to the supercomputer one. So GeoServer, server map server post keys are kind of out of question there. And of course, as Ed is not a web server, then it doesn't make sense to put this map JavaScript libraries there either. And then I put the slide about realistic expectations, because quite often I hear that, oh, I have an R script which takes, let's say, 5 hours on my computer. I put it to supercomputer, then it will be super fast, maybe 5 minutes. And this is not what's going to happen. And the supercomputers have pretty much the same kind of cores as laptops, so the speed won't be dramatically better. The only thing that they have is that there's so many of these cores. So the trick is to be able to use all of this, like even 10 or 20 cores in NGS context. What I have seen is pretty good already. And then, of course, one thing is to optimize your script. This we have seen that in some cases, you just read a little bit rewriting your script, then actually you maybe don't even need a supercomputer environment. A laptop will do this job in. We got once, I have a thing that would run 7 days. After a little bit rewriting, it took 15 minutes on a laptop, so. But that was a little bit strange. That was actually a Esri case, but yeah. And then I have been looking hard for software from GS side that would run in parallel. And that's not really a promising list. The only tool that I have found is Taudem. How many of you know Taudem? It's really specific for hydrological modeling or something. So although we have installed it to our system, I don't know anybody actually be using it because it's so unusual. And then there are a few softwares that are partly parallel, for example, sagages. But in Saga documentation, there is nothing. We kind of accidentally noticed that it's running in parallel. So if you're using Saga, then you pretty much have to try and see what it does. So and then there are some functions in R, especially in R raster package, that run out of the box in parallel. So to overcome this, most of the GS software run in one core normally, then there is basically three options that are mostly used. So one is using Python with a multi-processing package so that you do the parallelization yourself. It's pretty easy if you're working, for example, in different map sheets, or if you have these routings, millions to do, then it doesn't matter in which order you do. But if the order matters, then of course it becomes more difficult. And then the same way in R, there is actually, I think, at least 5 different packages for making your code run in parallel. And the limitation with Python at the moment, for us at least, is that you can use only one node, which means in old system 24 cores and in the new one 40 cores. But even that usually has been enough. In R, we have had people running on 256 cores, for example, so there, this limitation doesn't apply. And then we have still another option, which comes from the supercomputer itself. There is such a system for submitting your jobs there. And that one has an option of array jobs, where you basically can run similar computation for a lot of input files. Or like you can yourself choose if it's input files or if it's different parameters. But in NGS context, it's quite easy to use this array jobs. For example, if you have a lot of map sheets, then you can run each map sheet in one array job. Or if you have these routings, then you can just divide them to some 10,000 routings per script or something like that. And there is, of course, a small overhead in going to parallel, but usually it pays off. And then I put here that this array job shouldn't be too short, so at least 15, 20 minutes. For example, once we were just reprojecting 20,000 raster files, and then reprojecting one file takes, I don't know, seconds. So then we made, if I remember correctly, we made like 1,000 files in one batch job. So then it was appropriate length. We have also copied 10 terabytes of data about Finland to the system so that users don't need to copy themselves. It's, I think the most used one is the digital elevation model, but there, from the amount, there is most LiDAR data. There is a lot of LiDAR data. And all users can, as Finland is very good in that sense that we have a lot of open data, then it has been easy that we take only the data with open license, so everybody coming to the computer can use this just without asking anything from us. One thing that I thought still putting here is that we have made use of the virtual rasters of GDAL, which have helped managing the bigger raster data sets pretty nicely, that you don't actually have to care where the files are. You just point to the virtual raster and say your bounding box, and that's it. And we have even built such external overviews to the digital elevation data, which was kind of hack again. But now you can actually zoom in and out nicely in QGIS and see at the elevation data. And we have also a Python script made that people can make send own custom area virtual rasters. And then about the skills part, we have tried to provide as much examples and guidelines as we just can come up. We actually don't do any analysis ourselves, so it's kind of such problem that we have not that much experience, but we try to get something simple at least running in these ways. All the examples are public in the GitHub, so you can write down that link. I hope the slides come to be shared later. There is examples about Python and R and PDAL and routing. Routing is actually done with Python. And then we have also examples for the cloud part, how you set up PostGIS or Geo Server. And we also had one quite interesting case to put up something in Docker. It was the open drone map, because the dependency tree there was like such, ooh, we don't want to install it manually. Yeah, and then we also organize courses every year, maybe 3 or 4. And the materials of the courses are also public, so the link here again. You can go and check them up. The first ones are such supercomputer specific, how you run there something, but the lower ones are more general, how you use Python or R, or how you use different tools for LiDAR data analysis. I'm really hoping to have a machine learning for GIS course this autumn, but we're still gathering the materials and ideas. If you have any good hints about that, then please tell me. One word about the behind the scenes, especially as the old computer was really old already, we had to do a lot of manual installations. Those of you who have done manual installations of GDAL, then they have some idea. But that was just the beginning. And then after that, there was like endless number of libraries to install. So the new computer that we are now getting, it's newer, so at the moment at least we have been using as much as possible Conda. And in the new machine we will also have a SPAC installation system, which is I think only used in supercomputers, but there was already something ready for Saga and Grass, so we will see how they work out in practice. And then I'm also doing a lot of data transfer, and I'm somehow really would like to get some better tools than the tools from 80s, this Veget, RSync, and because moving like terabytes of data. It's slow and not so easy. As I said, what we have built is mainly for Finnish researchers, but there is a program called HPC Europe 3, so if you got interested and if you are from Europe, actually this, you can also worldwide apply for this. You can come to visit Finland and at the same time use this environment, and you get even your costs covered, so you can just apply. And otherwise also, if somebody else is doing something in the HPC environment, then I happily share the experience. Yeah, that was what I had.
Thank you, Kuli. If you have any questions, please.
Hello. Hi. Great presentation. Really like it. The only thing that you didn't mention, if you had any success with your user base or your system over there with distributing computing, that is a moving the jobs between the allocated nodes or having all the allocated nodes working in parallel. Meaning, we had like a very good success using GIS software by running a distributing computing solutions using either tools like a GNU Parallel to move the jobs between the nodes and go around the single node problem on not using only batch files to have like a create like 1,000 jobs. Have you used this kind of approach?
No, I don't even know what you're talking about.
I think the only way of distributing work is to send execute.
No, but there is this batch system that takes care of this. So you submit work to this system,
and
you just say that I need 20 cores, and you don't have any possibility to decide which of the nodes will take care of
this. No, it's like the SLARM environment gives you, when I'm submitting a job in our HPC, the SLARM environment tells me which nodes I'm allocated, and then I know these nodes, I'm having them for an X amount of time, so I'm distributing jobs to them through the internal network of the HPC.
No, this we haven't done.
All right, okay, that's fine, sorry.
Yeah. Okay, thank you. Time for another question.
You mentioned that in a supercomputer environment, it's not possible to run Windows software, but is it possible to run a virtual machine there and then Windows and Windows software within that?
On the cloud side, it is possible, but not on the supercomputer. But on the cloud side, basically, it's technically possible. The problem is only the Windows licenses.
Okay, I have a second question also. Coming from Statistics Finland, I'm curious in knowing, is there a strict definition for a research institute who can use your services?
Yes, there is a specific list.
Are we on that list?
No.
Thank you very much. And time for another quick question or quick answer? Nope? Okay. So thank you very much. Thank you, Julie.